following. The contributions can be made in any language that one is comfortable with.
Thank you very much. This is the key topic on the way forward. After all this information, then what? In many parts of the world, people have had to resort to violence, to change, to defeat monarchs. We are fortunate that we have not been pushed to that point. And we have had to develop strategies and tactics that are different from there. Every reality has to be confronted in a way that isn't by your time and circumstances. Strategy helps you to attain your ultimate goal. So that goal must be clear to you. And tactics assist you to put your strategies into place. It provides you with the means to move your strategy to attain the goal that you need. Doi came when we ask ourselves the question, have we attained self-determination and independence? And answer was no. Even though technically we were independent, but in reality we were dependent. Dependent economically, dependent on loans, dependent on aid, and more so, the minds of our people had not been liberated. We came together not as friends, we came together because of the demands of our country. We responded to those demands by accepting to form a political association that we call DOI. We'll have very clear objectives of moving Gambia to the next level of attaining the right to self-determination and independence, and promote self-reliant development. We wanted to move Gambia to the next level of the sovereignty of the people. So we had two objectives, an economic objective and a political objective. That's why we are called People's Democratic Organization for Independence and Socialism. We didn't call ourselves a political party. We see that we are a movement, we was building the party, because the party had to be built by a conscious people who know exactly where they are heading. So we felt that we build this organization, which is a political organization, a party in its actual sense, but in our own vision, we felt that the party rather than declared. We felt many may come, many may go, but what is important is to be consistent with the aspect. The first is people's democracy. It means a democracy where the people are conscious that they are putting leaders in office and know why they are putting them there. The independence means that we must create an economic base where we can say this is what we want and others will not dictate to us. And therefore, even though you may take loans, even though you may accept aid, they should not be the determining factor for your development. They should be supplement to your development. And we were convinced that we did not have an economic base that was determining our development. The supplements were more than what we were contributing to our development. A good example this year, where our budget, over 19 billion, over 10 billion, is coming from project grants and budget support. It's from the outside. So essentially, we are still dependent for providing the services that our people need. We are convinced that the country could be self-reliant. We've looked at our oceans, our possible minerals. We've looked at all sectors. We know we can process. We know we can facilitate greater development. And the country is very small, less than 2 million people. We are convinced that we can build up a better life for our people. That is why we started the whole program with telling you what could be done. That's why we are now coming to the issue. Because we were convinced of what we told you, we also felt that we should now build the party. And the party must move to win the people, because the party can never be in office if it does not have the support of the people. We started the process of raising the awareness of the Gambian people. Many people tell us today that yes, the reason why Doi has not made progress, you see this number of votes there for how many years, you see this party come and it gets this, you know, what is wrong with this? Something is wrong. Maybe the way Doi is doing politics is wrong. So if you are doing politics and you are not going to the national, you are not winning, then something is wrong. Some say that Jawara called Doi a communist party. That's why Doi could never make progress again. Let us tell you that Doi is the party that has helped to liberate the country to this level. When we started, we made it our strategic objective to liberate the minds of the Gambian people so that they can take charge of the country. When we went into the countryside, they did not know what a country was. And political parties that were in the opposition were in fact afraid to go to certain villages. Otherwise, they will be vigilant. Because those people also did not know what democracy was. And therefore, when you are an opposition party, you just go and patronize the people you can patronize. And since the ruling party always has more money, you will never come to power that way. I remember an incident in Upper Fulodo West, and the place is called Bantanto, but they changed. We heard over the air they were changing the name of the village to Dungbali. In Manika, you cannot enter this place. So it was a place where an opposition entered. That's how they called it. So we decided to challenge that notion. We got our permit to have a meeting there. So we went. The alcalde became confused. He went to the police station. did everything, came back with his motorbike, still moving about. You know that this man is confused because he is the one who declared that place to be a Dunkirk. To give the ruling party assurance that an opposition cannot meet there. We put out our sets. He said that we should not, but we went ahead, put out our sets. And so that the police must have told him that these people have permit and you cannot stop them. So instead they mobilized the young people who started to beat drums and en masse to start moving to where we were having our political right. I was the first to speak. And then they were coming closer and closer. Sidia also took the microphone to start speaking. And they were beating their drums and coming closer, but here and there they stopped beating and listening a bit. So when they listen a bit, then they start drumming again. They did that and did that, and you see that the drumming is slower and slower and lighter and lighter. So when they came close, the strongest guy who was leading them decided to rush and come. We thought he was coming to try. Then he sat down and listening to the meeting. He went up there giving spirit. He got up. People were there waiting. He got up and then went, started moving towards there. And all we saw was he stretched his hand and put it in his hand and went back and sat down. That person became the strongest militant in Upper Fulani West, who rode bicycles going everywhere carrying out cassettes of the party, so that he has passed away now, a blessed memory. But that shows you what Doi had done in this country. We had a very good meeting there, because we met the elders in the mosque, we prayed and left them. That is late at night, after the Friday, the late Easter prayer, and then they showed their happiness and wondered why such a message had not come to them. But another example is Nyomi Lamin, where Al-Kalu said, no, don't put fire on my head. Many of the villagers were afraid to come, but we had our meeting, strong microphones, and the whole village heard it. And maybe you will hear the clapping in the compound. So that has been the trend throughout the country. Never have we gone anywhere in the country without holding a meeting. And sometimes, I remember in Nyamina, we had a similar problem. And wanted to hold the meeting. The alcalde said no. He went to the chief. They did everything. We started the meeting. And he wanted to come, and the villagers held him and took him to his compound. We continued the meeting. We did not know that that same alcalde had come to the Bantaba and was lying down, listening to everything that we were saying. So we finished the meeting. And I said, well, let me enter the compound and greet him. And then one very interesting man said, no, the alcalde was lying in the bunch of us. So I went towards the alcalde. He said, Halifa Salabahima, what are you doing? So the whole situation is, he listened to the meeting, the man exposed him, but everything that old man will send his child to me afterwards, greeting and showing pleasantries. So in short, it's my last statement there, in Fast Chao, is a similar situation. They told us that since P.S. Ndiaye, no political party had ever held a rally in the Marabu village. You bring the colonels, go to the Marabu, and you go and wait for your look. We said, hey, we are not looking for luck. We are here to educate. They said, look at these foolish young people. What type of education? We say in this Marabu village, we know everything we want to know. We don't want to know anything about your politics. We said, but we have a permit. They said, you have not heard what we have said. Nobody had ever, Jawara had never held a meeting here. And we will not allow it. So we started. Then we held the situation. Then when the meeting continued, the old people, the young people started clapping. We said, no, don't clap. They said, no meeting has ever been held here, so we don't want any noise. They stopped them, and then the meeting continued. You see the elders coming. After a while, you see the elders say, huh? So in essence, my final statement here is, in Kuntawur, where you had Chief General Manketa at that time, we started the meeting, he came out and sat at this gate and listening until the meeting came to an end. He called us and was laughing. He said, do you know that Jawara called us and said that we should not take you people lightly? Now I know why he said that we should not take you lightly. Mm-hmm. But go on the way to start. This is the way. Continue talking lies. So who can say that Doi was isolated? Nobody has isolated Doi. Doi and integrity. I remember in the old man is over 90 going to his 100. When the thing started, he came out and sat at his gate. We went further, he went in. We finished the meeting, he called. And when we went, he said, when you started, I thought some, because I've never attended a political rally in my life. But after a while, I realized that it was not a sermon, this was I went in, but I was listening to him. He said, I listened until the end. The reason why I'm calling you is, this is not politics. You are engaging in sermon. And continue this. And bear in mind, happy analogy, bear in mind that there are some people, when you have your morning alarm call, he said, before you do it, they would have been there. Some will wait until you make the call, then they will get up. He said, some even after you make the sleeping until you knock their door. He said, but some you have to knock until you break the door before they wake up. But just continue. So in short, it is not true that Doi has ever been isolated. It is a long journey. And that the politics of patronage and the politics of enlightenment cannot be mixed. One must kill the other. And therefore we had to continue with the politics of enlightenment, which takes a longer time to bear fruit. But we are willing to wait for that time, because we believe that that is the only thing that is durable. That's the only thing that can deliver the goods. That is the only thing that can enable you to make a promise that will not fail. If you take any other route, you will promise and fail. So we started the process of enlightenment. It was supposed to be followed by the process of building branches. We succeeded in our night schools, in our nursery schools, in all our communities to inspire a lot of people who were ready to work with the party, who started to build branches all over the place. And we thought that by empowering them economically, we'll be moving faster. That is why in the rural areas, we had goose farms, we bought donkeys for the farming. Some did what they were supposed to do, some, because they were used to the politics of patronage, they felt that, well, we had money, so they went away with the donkeys. But essentially, this is the process that Doi had engaged in all over, trying to be as self-reliant as possible to build up a political base in the country. And we definitely succeeded in the first phase, which lasted from 1986 to 1994, when the coup d'etat occurred. So, when the coup, many people thought that these people carried out a coup for Doi. many young people came to us and said that these people were not politically aware. So if you see that they've carried out this coup d'etat and call you people, two people to come and join them, they want you to take leadership. They want to assist you. We told them that if they want change to be real, then they will call a multi-party conference, a national conference, attended by the parties, the religious leaders, so that we can say, well, this is what was done. Now let's carve a new way forward. Let's come up with a transitional program. Then, obviously, everybody will participate in the process. But to take over a country and make yourself a council that leads, to make law and run the economy, and then expect us to come and join you. So it means that the sovereignty of the people had been nullified, the sovereignty of the republic had been nullified, you have suspended the constitution, so you now come to join in. What will be the rule of law? What type of law will rule? Law that they make for themselves. So we felt that our duty was to help the country through a transition so that we restore the republic and restore the sovereignty of the people. We were even arrested for defying them. Who would have thought that the Gambian people would have learned a lesson from that? That the people who would refuse to be co-opted when they could have become ministers, enjoying all the privileges and giving people the patronage stamp there, money here and there, and they say you are a good person. Those people rejected all that to the point of being and taken to court. We defended ourselves in court. And after that, we continued to call for the transition to continue. Constitutional reform, we wrote what they should rely on, etc., etc. I will soon come to my conclusion. With all that, to move the country forward. All those who were arrested here and there, we called for their release. We were fighting for sanity for the country. If we were not here, terrible things would have happened here. Because I know certain people who suffered, who had to come to me for advice. Because change had come. You can even go towards revenge. But they were properly advised. And they never did anything that they were ready for revenge. And we should not put this under the carpet. I was in mile two with them in our first arrest in 83. And I knew what they explained. When they explained to me what they went through, I came out, I wrote it and sent it to the Minister of Interior. I knew how I struggled. Some of the reforms that took place in that prison was all as a byproduct of such letters. Those who were old enough to would have read such letters at that time. So in essence, we went through a whole process. There are things that are to reveal because we want to move from the past into the future. So in short, we did all that and then moved towards election. When we moved towards election, the Gambians should have said that it is doing that made for election to come to Gambia again, because the objective of the ruling council was to be like Libya, that is a no-party state, no-election state. The no-election was the agenda. We reversed that agenda in this country. If that agenda went, would you have had all these parties arising after 1992? But instead, some of them were campaigning that Doi was a collaborator of the coup makers, trying all sorts of remarks were being made to fight Doi again. And what we recommended at that time, why don't we all come together? Because they require parties to register. Let's not register because some parties could not register. Let us just make sure we get an independent candidate, and that person will only serve for 1 year, so that we change the country and start to move towards genuine democratic. But some felt that the head, this ethno-linguistic group will not have any influence in the country. If they support this particular party, then they are going to take over the country. They change the whole agenda. It led people nowhere but to deeper domination and control. In 2001, we recommended the same thing. What we recommended in 2016, we recommended in 1996, that's what we recommended in 2001, that's what we recommended in 2006, that's what we recommended in 2011 and 2016. Nobody could stop it, and I'll show you why. They rejected what we wanted in 2001. And then what happened? There was break in food. And then eventually, Anesthesia, and we went to Atlanta. Then they said, well, why don't we make Khalifa a coordinator so that we have a coalition? We agreed, even though we are National Assembly members. We even sacrificed those National Assembly seats. We bring them together. We established NAD, 6 by-elections. NAD won, NAD won 4. So the country was heading towards change. But it's the change where we don't want a party to lead. We wanted a change owned by the people so that we will go over here, educate the Gambian people, level ground created, and the people will support any party of their choice. But they knew that as long as we have that type of change, people become conscious, it will be difficult for anybody who wants to fool the people to be in power again. So that process was derailed in 2006. We decided, well, we'll go with the same thing in 2011, derailed. So you see, the tactic we were employing was that let us have a chain owned by everybody so that we build the best democratic practices and have an election where the Gambian people will finally decide which party can address their needs and aspirations after hearing all of them over the air what their programs are. That has always been our objective. That is the strategy we put in place in order to effect regime change, which was the objective, which was the goal. But you can see that they always sabotage that. But 2016, it had to be different. You, the Gambian people, could see the Gambia 4 months before the election. Nobody, most people did not believe that Gambia could change through elections. Now everybody say, yeah, this is the change we expected. 99.9% of Gambians never expected change ballot box on the 1st of December 2016. What people were expecting is war, and people were preparing for war. The UDP leader was in prison. Who could take the street? People who wait for you to give them a bag of rice, will those people get up and say they're going to remove Yahya Jammeh from the state? How? When he declared the election null and void, which party said, let us take the street and go to the state house and remove him? Which ethno-linguistic group? Which religious group? So many people could not believe that change could come through the ballot box. There was a state of hopelessness. Those who opposed him were telling opposition, go and demonstrate. Even though they will not tell those people who are linked to them to come to the opposition and bring the crowd and say, lead the crowd. They knew the level of consciousness of Gambians at that time. They do not change. So what would have happened? The burning of the APRC bill was a signal to those of us who can read politics and understand its dynamics. It was very clear to us that was going to be the threat. Nobody will be able to rise up to remove him, but many will be brave enough to go and do things, to burn things, to do things, and he will also continue to fight, and blood will be flowing. And ultimately, soldiers cannot continue to allow blood to flow on and on. In most instances, they will carry out a coup d'etat. So the best case scenario was that Gambia was heading towards a coup d'etat, and no one knows when the country will be put together again. And as we come closer to the elections, you could see people buying machetes, branding themselves, you will know their emblem so that people can identify each other. People were preparing for civil war. Nothing was certain again. So when Doi saw this, he employed the tactic that this time we will not call the political parties, because every time you call them, what we say, well, we the majority will lead, you know, then talk, and then everything collapses. So we said that as the presidential candidate of Doi, I would call all the presidential candidates so that we can talk about establishing a coalition. You know what the tactic was? Whoever it is will leave you behind and go. Even if two are left, we'll continue. That was the tactic. This time, nobody could stop a coalition. Whether it's two parties, three parties, number, but two, we will go. That was the idea. And when we called this meeting, most of the presidential candidates, six of them, most of them, four of them, never really want to attend. They continued with their campaign. Go to social media, you'll see what people were saying and what they were saying about Khalifa Sall. How I was distracting and directing, we know what to do, who should be supported, all sorts of remarks. Whenever they go to the people say, go back to the negotiating table, otherwise don't come to us. Now, coming to my last statement, UDP had a presidential candidate. Who was UDP's presidential candidate? Many had forgotten. UDP had a presidential candidate. UDP toured the country with his presidential candidate. Whilst we were there meeting to form a coalition. Now let me ask this question. 17th October, and this 30th October, is simply less than 2 weeks. Why would a presidential candidate take a pen and resign from that political party and go and become a presidential candidate of a coalition? You were really sure that if you stand for that party, you will win an election. Who will do that? Who on earth will do that? So essentially, that is what every Gambian should put in his or her mind. Election. Sign an agreement on the 17th of October. And at that material time, nobody had imagined that you could go and win an election. Or even that you would build it. So at the material time, that's when we had the agreement that the person will stand as an independent candidate so that no party will take ownership of that chair. That person will also be there for 3 years, because all those people who criticize for presidential cartel, the longer a person stays, the more the person will become entrenched. And self-perpetuating rule will continue. So let us make the time to be shorter. And the person will not stand in the next following election. That was agreed. And signed. So we agreed on those principles. And this is precisely in the 30th, we had a convention. Then candidate Barrow was selected. And he resigned from the UDP and stood as an independent. From October 30th to 1st December, it's just 1 month and few days. We managed to campaign and win an election. And in the campaign, we had to re-educate all those young people, because the insults, the anger had to be contained. And we succeeded in containing it. And we move all over the country and back without arrests, without the old beatings and you know, if we don't beat, you know, the attacks and arrests would have stopped the whole campaign before you even come to the south. How would we have won an election? So we managed the whole situation until we could deliver victory. So it is important to bear in mind that the then UDP leader was in prison, and Dembo Bojan, who worked tirelessly, and Ajay Yamsek, tirelessly to be able to at least come to this meeting, which was our final meeting, to be able to prepare the coalition. So that was our strategy. That was our strategy to effect regime change. And our form of coalition that no party will own, so that we will effect the change. And during the impasse, everything could have gone. But we managed the impasse. And I must constantly emphasize that the police had to be seen, the military has to be seen, all the people who mattered had to be involved in the process, that the country was faced with either change through peaceful means or a civil war. And in a civil war, external forces will intervene and we'll lose our country. And that they had nothing to gain by us losing our country. Every Gambian can remember that when President-elect Barrow was coming from his Brushubi residence to the Kairaba Hotel, that the police will sweep the street. No transport in the street until he arrives there. And that continued until he left the country for Senegal. All that was negotiated. So in short, on the 19th, when he was sworn in, there were powers who called attack. And we would have immediately gone into a state of war. I used to leave my residence to go to Barrow's residence just to meet those who, young people we had mobilized to provide security, to guide them so that they can move into the bushes and surrounding areas, because if there was war, they will be the first to be attacked. happiness. But with surely having full understanding of the implication of war and fully convinced that the ground was fully managed, they continued with the discussion. So my last statement in this analysis is Germany left to go to the airport, guarded by soldiers, Gambian soldiers, and security personnel. And the airport was occupied by Gambian soldiers and security personnel. And he flew with Gambian soldiers, security personnel, still in control of the airport. On that day, members of the coalition supporters also went to the airport. The police, the security did not attack them. They called the coalition leaders. The coalition leaders, they also called me, but the coalition leaders also called me. This could have been a trick where you go, they capture you and make you a human shield. But I went there to tell the coalition supporters that Jammeh is coming with his own supporters, and if there's a clash here, we have a problem. Since this man is going, leave the airport, let him go. If Barrow is coming, you welcome him. That's the whole situation. And thereafter, work with the security to ensure that nobody broke into the banks. No properties were destroyed. No property. Everything that usually happened in a situation where Jammeh was not in town, Barrow was not in town, there was complete vacuum. And in many instances, in any country, everything would have jumbled up, everything would have gone to pieces. As the result, some of the soldiers will even take their arms maybe to the casamas or break into the vaults and take all this money in the banks and see where to go. But everybody stayed put because of hope that a new government emerge where fair play will exist and people will understand each other so that we move forward. And when Barrow was coming, tens of thousands of people went to welcome him, and a peaceful country was handed to him. For us, our strategic objective, regime change, has been achieved. We take it forward. And therefore, as far as there is concerned, we went to the drawing board to say, after this, then what next? To us, what we anticipate is that President Barrow will be the executive, and everybody will forget about their political parties, serve the country faithfully for 3 years, some of us in the National Assembly, some in cabinet. And we thought that the National Assembly will have independent National Assembly members rather than belong to political party, and independent in terms of the council, so that the 3 years will be a 3-year transitional period for Gambia to bring about the political transformation that we have all anticipated, to create the sovereign Gambia. By using the radio, the television, education, so that we create national unity, eradicate all ethno-linguistic differences and religious differences, and people to see that they are now part of a nation, and we ensure that we have a just nation, which will have a new start. That is what important. The whole world appreciated that and became fully ready to support the Gambia. But as you can see, from began to say this, they had their own aspirations in terms of starting to mobilize to build their own political base. So for us, we felt that, well, yes, you can use that language, but this is normal. No political interest. And that's what we want you to understand, that we understand all those political interests. That is why we said that we will not be part of cabinet, because there are certain decisions that we will not be able to accept as our decisions. And if you are in a thing and tradition, you should leave. And to go into a thing and resign later, that shows immaturity. It means it shows insincerity, because you should have known that in the first place. That is why we have said it long before anybody was moved, that we would not be part of a cabinet. Now, ultimately, something will happen and you are removed from that cabinet. Then what would you explain? So therefore, for us, our tactic is very clear, that this is what we own. All of us own it together. It's a collective problem. So now, we choose where we can serve the country best. And we believe in the National Assembly, we can criticize everything that is wrong with government, and nobody can remove us from the government. And that's what we are doing now. So in short, that is the tactic we have employed. And the council election is coming, that is the final phase of the electoral process. What Doi has done now is to go to the drawing board. And since the council election is the final phase, we want still to continue the process of bringing people together. That is why we have said that those two independent candidates could apply. If there are more than one, then we can build a consensus, put together so that they can choose one to stand. If not, we have a primary. Just like you had in Banjul, we have a primary to select one. But if there are other candidates with the same way of thinking and same mission, who are ready to work together and see the council election as a transitional election, then they can also come and be part of the process of primary, where no matter where they come from, we will engage them and hold a primary for one to be selected. And out of the person who is selected, then they can work together and galvanize to compete with anybody who does not want to be part of that process. This is the tactic that Doi has employed to show that we are not necessarily concerned to take over this country at this stage as a party. We want the country to have a healthy trust, where the people will be one and the people will take charge of their destiny. So that is why at this moment, for the council election, that is our stand. Now in preparation for the next electoral cycle, we have gone to the drawing board and we have agreed that in 2018 we'll hold the Doi Congress, which will be a major Congress. And the Congress will be prepared for now. We don't wait until the time. In preparation for that Congress, we are now at this moment working hard to see that the organs of the party, we have the Central Committee, we have the Political Bureau, we have the Organizing Bureau, we have the Information Bureau, we have the Bureau on Women's, we have the Youth Bureau. So our intention is to build these bills so that the Central Committee will be nation-based and should bring more young people and women in it. And that's what has happened out of our last Congress. Because the last Congress agreed that each region must have a male and female representative in the Central Committee. So automatically you have 7 members, women who are women, in the Central Committee. And if you gauge the age group, they are much younger now after that decision. So what we now have is that member in the Central Committee, we intend to build the regional bureaus. So the bureau in Banjul is going to be reinforced and built. This bureau will now work with the youth bureau, women's bureau of the party, Bureau for Women Affairs, the organizing bureau, the Bureau for Political Affairs and Information Bureau. The Political Affairs Bureau will be carrying out this type of citizenship and education for citizenship, membership and leadership. And we'll be producing many cassettes in our languages and many brochures, etc., so that massively we will be present everywhere, we will be visible everywhere. So that is the task that has started and is going to intensify in preparation for the next electoral cycle. The Women's Bureau also will have representative male and young girl and an adult from each regional bureau to work with the Central Bureau of Women Affairs and Children Affairs so that they will be organizing activities together with the team that they will build. And we hope out of the membership here, those teams, people will volunteer to be part of those teams. They'll be visiting women in their confines, in their areas, whatever activities they have, you know, to at least carry out the policy of one sensitized 10, once mobilized 10. Once you know, and we want that to be structured, count 10 people that you will identify, that I will talk to them until this information that has convinced me will be passed on to them so that they'll also be convinced. So once those people continue convincing, you have a spot meeting, then you organize a spot meeting, all those people will be present so that we give you more information and more clarification. And the same thing with the youth. The same thing with the organizing bureau. Those who have talent, artistic, drama, etc., we want to organize them. So that if the talent is saleable, we can even move to that level with the person or the group of persons. So that through the drama, we can in fact create more education, give more education. So that is the way forward. The diaspora has already started their organizing. They have had this type of training and they are also organizing at that level. And we want to link the diaspora with people in this region. So in essence, the party is ready to carry out village to village, ward to ward sensitization programs and then create committees in each of these wards of male, adult, female, adult, and youth. It starts with a committee of 4 and increases for any size. But those people will serve as the nucleus to expand and expand the consciousness of those people in the area and get them more involved. This is the plan we have, and we are already employed. We have toured the whole North Bank, and then after the tour, we are going village to village in the constituencies. And we are doing the same thing with the South Bank. And we'll come to KMC and then Kumbajo. But with this new development and this strong membership, maybe we don't have to, you know, do what we planned before. We can even build up the committees from the consciousness that you people have gained. It all depends on your determination to participate. All those who are ready to participate, it's not force. Even going to vote is participation. But if you want to be more active and something inside you is pushing you to be more active, then be active and energize you so that we move forward.
Thank you very much.
We will be struggling to build as much resources as possible so that the headquarters will be equipped with all the facilities necessary to carry out this type of meetings and other types of meetings and conscientization so that all of us begin to exchange ideas more frequently. And somebody has raised, what could we do for each other? Yes, that's where we want to move to, that there are people with talents. Some are engaged in business activities. How do we bring them together to work together and build something bigger and own shares? And we encourage them to be honest to each other so that they can contribute more, you know, to the development. How can we have projects where some individuals who want to do something will be able to get seed money, you know, to do it and pay back so that it becomes a revolving fund? Not for political reason, but let's, after knowing what we should do, then let's just ask. One is not giving you something as bribery, but this is just a process of building towards the future. Yes, that's what is encouraged. That's what we are propagating. It can go to skill development. Those with skills use others to be into apprenticeship so that those things can help others to gain more information, especially the younger generation. Yes, we can move into that. We are in a position to know what projects are available. We'll hunt those projects. If they are supposed to benefit some, this folly this way and this is the way to get it, you know, those issues also are there so that we start to build the joint community. All those initiatives are initiatives that after this thing, you can go back, discuss at the constituency level, at the regional level, so that we move in that direction. This is the task. Of course, parties are the same because they have different orientation. But they, here and there, they can collaborate. And what we anticipate from our partners is not to be criticizing or undermining our initiatives as if we're not collaborating. Because our agenda, of course, is different from theirs. For the regime change, our agenda is the same. But for the next electoral cycle, our agenda cannot be the same. So we must agree and collaborate on the regime change agenda, but for the next electoral and our own agenda, and they should respect us and support us, and we support them. We all want a better country. That's what is important. So to conclude, therefore, we want DOI members to be conscious of what the party is all about. My conclusion, I'll just give you an example. An old man who came to me and said, I was talking to somebody who is your opponent. And he said, see, the only problem with DOI is a communist party. I asked the old man, what is communism? He said, I don't know. I told that person, ask him what is communism. And the old man went and asked the person who was coming. He said, you know, this communist the person was just saying, he's coming, but cannot explain anything the old man could understand. And he came back to me. I said, you've gone to a knowledgeable person. This person is supposed to be a knowledgeable person. But he accuses us of something, but he cannot even explain to you to understand what is bad about us. I said, well, if you say these people are saying good things and are doing good things, what can be said that make you think that they are bad? You know, that's not possible. But I said, but I will still explain to you what this thing they talk about is. And I will explain that to you people. In science, there are things. People have always been writing and thinking. They have not been lucky to be part of political parties that take over governments. It's just people who take their ideas and talk about them. But what is said about us is not something that can exist in our current era. Because what it is talking about is saying that early phase of human society is just like if you go to a cabilo. If you go to a cabilo in a rural area, in a cabilo, you don't have prisons, you don't have a police force, you don't have an army. What you have, people living and then all going to work in the family farm and bring it and put it in the family store. And whoever is time for you to cook, you cook for the rest. And people will eat. So with that type of a situation, you are saying that everybody is working and everybody is working. In fact, the theory is to each according to his ability, for each according to need. It means that everybody is working and you just take what you need. This is a type of society which somebody envisaged that in a future society, there will be so much abundance in society. Everybody will just be working, but you will have enough housing, enough facilities that you do not need a state. You don't need a police because nobody will steal again, nobody will commit a crime. So you don't need a prison, you don't need a police force, you don't need an army, you don't need any. It's just like you don't need a prison, you don't need an army, because if you do something wrong, elders will advise you and then you'll cooperate. You know, that type of society. It's not China, it's not Soviet Union where you have these mighty armies ready with nuclear weapons ready to wipe the world from the face of the earth. So, it's to understand that that type of society is not meant for our type of society today. We are building a society where the state will accept its responsibility. As it is stated under section 1, subsection 2, that is, we elect you, your duty is to promote our general welfare and prosperity. That is the level we are in today. And we have stated it very clearly. Anybody who comes to you and tell you anything different is a dishonest person, and that person is invited by us to debate anywhere so that we can prove to all members of society that these are the dishonest people who do not want people to know what the truth is. The message is now before you. Nothing is left behind. I will listen to any question that you have, and then we conclude in peace, and then prepare you of going for one to enlighten 10, one to mobilize 10. If one mobilizes 10, that's 10 people. 10 mobilizes 10, that's 100. 100 mobilizes 10, that's 1,000. 1,000 is 10, that's 10,000. 10,000 mobilizing 100,000. 100,000 mobilizing 10, we've taken over the country. So there is absolutely no reason to say that change is not inevitable. if we have the will, the determination to take charge of our destiny. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, guys. That's the tax now. One to mobilize 10 to convince 10. If you know that you have the idea of doing, your tax is to at least 10 of those people to know the idea of DOI and mobilize them to DOI. That's your tax. Then see you tomorrow. We will continue with the citizenship education with Honorable Halifa Salla, where he will tell you your citizen's right and how somebody can become a citizen. Bye from me. Thank you.